It's a good morning, isn't it? Some of you think it is. That's good. That's good. So, well, we're going to get ready. We're going to have communion. We're going to celebrate this morning. How many of you know communion is a celebration? Well, some of you know that. Some of you are going to know that. Hopefully all of you are going to know that. I woke up this morning, and I'll share about Corbin a little bit later. I'll share about what's gone on in our family this last week. A lot of good stuff. Praise the Lord. But I woke up this morning, and this is the first Sunday of December, and you know, we didn't do it last month because life. But we try to do communion the first Sunday of the month. Not because the Bible says you have to do it the first Sunday of the month, not because, well, most Assembly of God churches do it the first Sunday, but because we want to have a regular time of celebrating and worshiping the Lord and recognizing the body. But my prayer this morning as I woke up and was preparing, I said, Lord, I don't want communion this morning to be just a rite, just something that we do. You know, rite is the same root word for ritual. It's just something that you do and then you feel good because you did it, because you checked the box off. And I think if we'd all be honest with ourselves, there's times that we go through the motions. Yeah, you could probably repeat after me. You could probably repeat with me or just say along with me almost exactly what I'm going to say, because I don't always say the same thing at communion. I use different passages, but you know the basis. Oh, let's remember the bread, it's the body of the Lord. Let's remember the wine, it's the blood of the Lord. And without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. But when was the last time you took a moment to really take that in and understand what it was that Jesus was saying at that Last Supper? What it was that he was encouraging us to remember? When was the last time you say, you know what, there's something more to this than just a cracker and some juice? This really represents something powerful. If it doesn't represent something powerful, if you don't, and hear me this morning, if you don't believe that these elements represent something powerful, something important, then I would encourage you to not bother taking it, because you're wasting your time. Amen. And we can't gain favor with the Lord just by going through the motions. Amen. Come on. We go through the motions because we have favor with the Lord. Amen. Okay, and I don't mean go through the motions as just blind and dumb, just go through it. We do what we do because of the relationship we have with the Lord. So I'm going to ask our servers to come forward. I'm going to encourage you to prepare your hearts this morning to observe communion, to really think this morning about what these elements are. I want to encourage you to hang on to the elements so we've all been served. We're going to take this together because this is something that we do as a family, the body. And you think about the body, your mouth can't eat without the rest of your body being nourished or getting some benefit from it. So we're going to do this together. And let me encourage you also, take this time to get quiet with the Lord. You know, we're encouraged that we ought to examine ourselves and we ought to, but you know, it's even more powerful when you ask the Holy Spirit to help you examine yourselves, because we probably all have blind spots, don't we? The things we know it's there, but we don't want to look at it. But if we say, Holy Spirit, open my eyes and help me to examine. Don't let me brush over blind spots. I want to do this right. And we'll take communion together. you stand with us this morning? Yeah, I got so many things running through my head, things that I could say and share about communion as we get ready for this. I don't know what you're going through in your own life, what kind of battles and struggles you're facing. You may be in a season of joy and peace where everything is great. But you might be standing next to somebody who's in a valley season. Everything's not great. It's hard. It's difficult. But know this. Jesus knows where you're at, and he is with you. And that's, you know, when Jesus initiated this communion, it was the night before he was going to be betrayed, and he knew what was about to happen. He was heading to the worst day of his life, and he knew that. And yet in Luke's account, he says, I've eagerly desired to have this meal with you. See, in spite of what he was about to face, he was focused on those that he loved, those that were around him, those that he was calling into this relationship. He also knew that those men sitting around the table with him were going to face some of the worst stuff that they'd ever faced within the next 24 to 48 hours. But he promised he'd never leave them or forsake them. So whether you're on the mountaintop or you're in the valley, understand the Lord, he knows intimately. He cares deeply. And he's with you continually. Sometimes we just need to open our eyes of faith to understand that. So there's three elements, there's two parts to communion. There's the bread and there's the wine. There's two parts to a cross. There's the horizontal and the vertical. There's two parts to our Christian life, the flesh and the spirit. And they all tie together. You see, this first part of communion, the bread, is Jesus' physical body that was beaten for us, and we're invited to take and partake of that. But it also correlates with that horizontal bar on the cross that Jesus was headed to. Because we are all called to be part of the body. And so it correlates also with the physical part of our spiritual experience, the natural. We have relationship one with another. And in fact, in 1 Corinthians, when Paul is talking about communion, he first brought some correction that, you know, the issue, they didn't recognize the body of Christ. And it wasn't the risen Christ, it was the body, their brothers and sisters, that they weren't recognizing. So this morning, would you take a moment to recognize the body of Christ around you? Your brothers and sisters. If we're going to spend eternity together, we better get used to one another. Just take that piece of bread and just hold it up. Lord, this morning as we get ready to participate in this, Lord, this holy moment, we thank you for your great love. Jesus, we thank you for sacrificing your body, your physical, literal body that this bread represents. Lord, thank you for taking the beating that we deserve. And Jesus, as we take this together, we want to recognize not only your physical body, but Lord, we want to recognize this body that you've given us, our brothers and sisters. Lord, we want to commit to recognizing and honoring and caring for one another as you care for us. Lord, would you bless this bread now as we take it in your name? Amen. Go ahead and take it. So the second element in communion, obviously, is the juice. And it represents specifically the blood of Jesus. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And the blood of bulls and goats could never atone for the sin of man. And so Jesus came and lived a perfect life. 100% man, blood running through his veins. It also represents that vertical part of the cross, a connection between us and God, because as his blood was shed, as we receive that forgiveness, we're put into a right relationship with him. We're restored to right relationship. And that's the spiritual part of this, is our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Just take that cup and hold it up. Lord, this morning as we hold this cup of juice, we recognize what it symbolizes. Lord, your life. Your word says that the life is in the blood. Your life that was laid down for us. Your blood that was shed. That when we receive it, Lord, makes us whiter than snow. Lord, we thank you for this act of love, and we thank you for your forgiveness. Jesus, I pray that as we take this, we'd really grasp, we'd really understand to the best that we can the love that you have. Lord, not only understand, but accept, even if we can't understand. Be glorified, Jesus, in your name. Go ahead and take the cup. Now, church, just begin to give him thanks this morning. Give him thanks for bringing you through another week, another month. Giving you another day to open your eyes and open your mouths and give him praise. Give him thanks for his great love and passion. Lord, this morning we do give you thanks. Thank you for allowing us to celebrate. Thank you for allowing us to slip our feet under the Master's table this morning. Lord, thank you for what you did that paved the way for us to be here, Lord, for us not only to be here, but ultimately be with you eternally. And now, Jesus, I pray that you would challenge us, Lord, that you would transform us, that you would, Lord, that you would build us into that body that you've called us to be. We'll be quick to give you all the praise, Lord, in your precious name. Amen. Well, since you're standing, most of you are standing, whatever, go ahead and take a minute or two and greet those around you. Tell somebody you're glad that they're here today. We'll get back at it.
Savior of the world. grace of God. She looks upon the great I am, the gift of heaven in her hand, born to save the sons of earth. He was born to give him second birth.
Good morning, Mountain View. Good morning, Mountain View. Thank you for finding your seats. Thank you for returning to your seats. Thank you very much. Uh-oh, music stop. Gotta stop dancing. In a moment, we're going to have Carlene play for us on her flute, a beautiful song. And I have a couple announcements just to share with you today. First of all, a men's breakfast has been postponed till January due to circumstances. We won't say what kind of circumstances, but anyway. We have membership class coming up this next Sunday. It's after church, right here in the dining room. And if you haven't signed up for it, would like to, be free to sign up. It's out there in the hallway, sign up sheet. And we need to know how many people are going to be there so we can order pizzas or pick up pizzas for everybody. So that's one of the reasons why we need everybody to sign up. We have a pastor appreciation December still going, although it was October, but we kind of flew by it and didn't participate for some reason. So we're doing it in December, and if you still want to give and show appreciation to the pastoral staff here, feel free to do that, to mark that on the calendar or your envelope in front of you. And also, we have a special request here. Abernathy Assembly of God Pastor Truesdale family. The family is struggling to make, you know, ends meet and stuff like that because the church isn't very big in the first place. So with, I guess, COVID and everything else that's going on, there hasn't been a lot of influx of money. So if we could help them, that'd be great. It's Pastor Truesdale. If you want to mark the envelope, just say Pastor Truesdale. Or just S. Abernathy. You can say Abernathy on it. And with that, I think that's all I have for today. Can we have the ushers come forward? All right, let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for gathering us here to get together today and giving us safe journeys, Lord, to and from. We thank you so much for everything that you have given to us financially. You provided for our needs, Lord, and that you have promised in your word to do that. And we thank you, and we give back to you the tithe and the offering, Lord, because it belongs to you. And we thank you so much for everything that you've done. In your name, amen.
Carlene. Mary, did you know? That's a great question, isn't it? I will, if you'll allow me a minute, I'll give you a quick report on Corbin, and then we'll get into, you know, the message. The really short part of the report is, praise God, Corbin's home. So, if you're not familiar with Corbin or who Corbin is, that's my two-year-old or two-and-a-half-year-old grandson. He, a little over 2 weeks ago, ended up having a seizure and was rushed to the hospital and total kidney failure through E. coli, some strange strain of E. coli that turns into what they call HUS. I could not pronounce the words even if I knew them. It's a long Latin thing. But basically, it's really, really bad. And I was encouraged, don't Google it. So I didn't. So anyway, he was very sick. And doctors around here didn't know what to do, so we ended up taking him down to Randall Children's Hospital. This is all on the same night. And, you know, over the next couple of days, an awful lot of praying, an awful lot of crying out to God, an awful lot of holding on to each other was going on, an awful lot of looking at this little guy that's lifeless, and hearing all of this bad, bad, bad news. And then Sunday rolled, that was a Thursday, I believe, Thursday before Thanksgiving, and then you know, you pray with faith, and you pray believing. But how many of you, I mean, let's just be honest here, you pray with faith and you're praying with believing, but you're also looking and not seeing. Amen. And there comes a struggle. There comes a time of, come on, Lord. You know, and I can even remember back to a message that I had preached, and I really, it sometimes frustrates me when either you, as, you know, people, friends, family, or the Lord reminds me of things that I've preached. You know, like, I got to live this now, right? And the particular message had to do with, well, when you pray, Lord, your will be done, what if God's will is different than your will? I did not want to think about that. Like, Lord, I know I preach that. I don't want that applied, because I don't want to be afraid of what could possibly happen here. I know it in the back of my mind, but I don't want to think about it. I think that was about, I don't know, last Saturday night, after a week or so. And then last Sunday, as we're in the midst of worship, we were singing a song about that mentioned he turns dry bones into armies. And that got me to thinking, and I opened up my Bible in Ezekiel 37, you know, the valley of dry bones. And those of you that were here might remember, I got up and just said, hey, you know, this is what I'm getting out of this. And this is, I know it's for me, but maybe it's for you as well, that though Ezekiel was told to prophesy to the dry bones and that they were going to come to life, even after he had been faithful and obedient, he prophesied to those dry bones, they did not come to life. I mean, they came together and muscle came over them and sinew and skin, and all of a sudden Ezekiel is standing not amongst a bunch of dry bones, but he's standing amongst a bunch of dead bodies. And I'm really not sure what would be worse. Personally, I think standing amongst the dead bodies would be worse than standing amongst a bunch of bones. Dead bodies are just not attractive. But it was in that moment, and again, we don't know how much time passed. We don't know if this was just a matter of, you know, 30 seconds or if this was a matter of an entire day. We don't know how long time passed that Ezekiel stood there looking at these dead bodies going, where's the life? Where's the life? Lord, you told me I did what I was supposed to do, and I don't see the life. And then at some point, I know that as we read it, it seems like it happened like that. But don't ever assume that things just happen like that for people in Scripture and they don't happen like that for you. God is the same, and so people dealt with stuff just like we deal with stuff. And so anyways, after however much time it was, and I can only imagine the frustration and the discouragement and the confusion that Ezekiel was facing, the Lord spoke to him again and said, "Prophesy again to the four winds in my name and command that life to come in." And I thought as I was reading that and contemplating, I thought, I think that's where I'm at. I need to speak again to life for Corbin. I need not be frustrated standing here and certainly in the natural we get frustrated. I'm not superhuman or anything. I'm just saying I need to make a decision. I'm gonna speak again. And I did that last Sunday, and some of you did that as well. And I don't know how many of you have received an answer to your prayer last week, but I can tell you this, that when I got back to the hospital on Monday and they ran the blood report talking about his kidney function numbers and all of this stuff, there was a big jump in change. There was, I don't even remember the numbers, but it was significant. It was significant enough that the nephrologist, the kidney doctor, very professional, Dr. Lee, wonderful, wonderful kidney doctor, you could see in her eyes as she was telling us that this doesn't just happen. And she said, you know, if this trend continues, we could talk about sending him home earlier. Now, this was on Monday. She's saying, you know, maybe in another couple of weeks, rather than 3 weeks, maybe a week and a half or so. So, all right, this is good. This is good. She said, we'll test the numbers again tomorrow. The next day, they had changed again by about 50%. I mean, just, and she's saying, you know, again, it was, she didn't, she, doctors have to be really careful what they say and how they say it. And pastors have to be really careful too, but I get to be careful on another point. I get to be careful and make sure I praise God and say he does perform miracles. Because now it wasn't 2 weeks down the road or a week and a half down the road. She said, maybe Monday. Maybe Monday. She said, we're going to look at numbers and see if maybe we're going to schedule to take his port out because he doesn't need dialysis. There's no reason for him to have dialysis anymore. We'll take that port out. And then we'll start checking. He came home yesterday. He made such an improvement. He made such an improvement. And yeah, he was getting feisty with the doctors and the nurses, and that was great to see. But he came home yesterday. And if you were to walk into the house today, if you were to walk in there right now, they're home, you know, and just recouping. It's been a long couple of weeks for Courtney and for Corbin and for Sissy, for Chloe, his twin sister. But if you were to walk in there now, you wouldn't know there's ever anything wrong with that kid. Right. Now, hey, the battle isn't over. His numbers still have to adjust. He's still not at 100%, but boy, looking at him, you couldn't tell. So I'm going to continue to trust the Lord, but I share that because I want to encourage you. We've had a good result, and I praise God for that. But church, and I'm speaking to myself, you got to stand on the Word of God. You have got to follow His lead, and as He led last week, and we followed, I wasn't the only one that followed. There was others here that prayed. The answer's coming. If it hasn't come yet, don't worry. The answer's coming. Okay, and I don't want to be, you know, a wet blanket on this and say, well, you know, sometimes God's will is different than your will. We know that. If that happens to be the case, God's will is better. We just don't always see it right away. But be encouraged. He hears our cries, and sometimes it's the pause. It's the pause that's so important. Because it gives you the opportunity to get up and go again. Amen?
Amen?
Thank you for all of your prayers. Great to see Forrest here today. Another one back from the brink. Yeah. Praise God. So our God is still in the miracle business. Oh, by the way, thank you to whoever decorated. I was not here, so I think Anne Marie, I would suspect Anne Marie, and I don't know who else, but thank you. If you were involved, thank you so much. So, Joe, you're getting fingers pointed at you. Well, I know Joe and Cole got trees, but anyway, you know who you are. Hopefully you're listening. So, if you have your Bibles, let's get this going, or continue it going. If you have your Bibles, take them out, hold them up, repeat after me. This is the Word of God. It's able to make me wise. It's useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness. And this message is for me. All right, take that Bible and open up to James chapter 5. We're going to start in verse 7. Maybe the most important sermon you've heard in a long time. Maybe. We're going to talk this morning about everybody's favorite topic, patience. Oh. Patience. Patience is one of those things that we know that we need, but we just don't really like to talk about it. We want others to have it with us, right? We want other people to have patience with us. Please be patient. God's not finished with me yet. We want others to be patient with us. And we know that we should demonstrate patience towards others. But we're convinced. Think about this. And you might laugh at this, but you know this is true. We're convinced that we shouldn't ask God for patience. Because if we do, you know where I'm going. He'll allow us to go through. Some might say he'll make us go through, or he'll take us through, but he'll allow us to go through some difficult situation that's going to develop patience in us, or it's going to destroy us. It's like that's the only two options. And so the adage is, don't ask God for patience. Don't ever pray for patience. Can I just say, that's dumb. That's dumb. God wants us to have something, but we don't trust him enough to be willing to say, okay, I'm going to pray and ask the Lord to help develop this sin, because I am so convinced that he's going to make me go through something that's going to be so miserable it'll either kill me or help me to become what he wants me to be, and I'm not sure what's worse. What? That's kind of dumb. But it's important for us to have patience. It's important for others to have patience as they deal with us. But we're at this confusion. Let's pray. Lord, this morning as we open your word and we take a look at it, I pray that you would help us to get out of it what you put into it. Help us to, Lord, receive from you this morning. Give us ears to hear. Lord, even beyond that, to listen to your Holy Spirit. Give us a heart to receive and, Lord, hands to act. We'll be quick to give you all the thanks and the praise, Jesus, in your name. Amen. So we're continuing our series through the book of James, and we're all the way into chapter 5 and at verse 7. And this is what it says. It says, be patient then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient. That's the second time in two sentences. Be patient and stand firm because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against each other, brothers, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Verse 10, brothers, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered. You've heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. It's kind of it almost seems like a strange shift in thinking. You know, we're warning those who are rich. We talked a couple weeks ago about, you know, maybe this wealth isn't simply silver and gold like we consider wealth, but maybe this wealth really is our faith, and we need to be sharing that, not hoarding it up in the last days. We go from that to be patient. Two words, be patient. Sometimes it's important what's not written or what's not said. Did you notice he did not say, pray for patience? And he did not say, ask the Holy Spirit for patience. He just came out now under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. James didn't make this stuff up on his own. Holy Spirit was speaking to him and through him. Right? We agree on that? Amen. All right. So, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he comes out with these two words, be patient. Be patient. Well, how do I just be something that doesn't seem to be natural to me? But if the Holy Spirit, if God is saying be, then we must have the ability to be. Because he's telling, right? You tracking with me? So he says be. Let's think. Let's do a little digging. Patience is part of the ninefold fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, and everybody's favorite, self-control. So it is part of it. It's part of that ninefold fruit of the Holy Spirit that is being developed within every believer. If you have received forgiveness from Jesus Christ, if you've accepted him as Lord and Savior, this fruit, which includes patience and self-control, is developing in you, along with love, joy, peace, all these others. It is. And it's not something that you have to make happen. Okay, how many of you have fruit trees in your yard? You got fruit trees? Or if you're not fortunate enough to have fruit trees, you got blackberry bushes? How many of you have ever had to try to make blackberries grow? More often we try to make blackberries not grow. Although we love the berry, we just don't like the bushes. I've got two apple trees outside my bedroom out here, and I have never heard them grunting and groaning trying to make an apple. It just happens. The apples in season just appear. Now, there's not apples on them year-round. About August, September, they're done. I've still got a couple apples hanging on the trees because I haven't had the time or the energy or the desire or whatever to get out there and actually pick them this year. They fall down, and my grandkids like to throw them. Go feed the cows. You know, that's fun. I found out, you know those little dog toy slingers, they sling tennis balls? These apples are like the same size. And my dog loves to chase them. And, it's sad because these are actually good apples. They're good tasting. They make great applesauce. They make, just great chewing on apples. Apple pie, I imagine. great things like that. But we just, it just hasn't been the year for us to do that. But I get out there and chuck them, and the dog goes running after them. She hasn't figured out how to bring them back, but I don't really care, because I'm really trying to get them away from, because then bees get at them and whatever. Anyway, here's the point. That tree or those sticker bushes, they don't have to try hard to create that fruit. When the season comes along, that fruit is there, and every part of that fruit is there. Those apples, every single one of those apples has a stem, and it has a core, and it has seeds, and it has the skin around it, and it's got the meat of the apple, every single one of them. Some look different than others, but they got it all. And so as believers, you need to understand that patience is one of those things that is being developed in you as part of that fruit. Now, here's the difficult thing that you might not like to hear. If you are not allowing, or if you do not have that part of the fruit coming in, you'd better check your root, because you might not be connected. Hate to be the guy to have to break it to you, but if you don't have the fruit of the Spirit being developed in your life, and that fruit has all nine pieces, if you don't have that developing in your life, you might want to check your connection to the Father. You might want to check your connection to the root, because you might have got snipped off, clipped off, broke off. You might have moved off. He won't ever leave. But if you're connected and you're walking in relationship with Him, these things will be developed in your life. It will happen. It's fruit. It's not like you have to try real hard. The hardest thing that you're going to have to do most of the time is allow it to happen. Now, the allowing it to happen is the part that gets difficult, because then we get scared of what I have to go through. We get scared of the process. Don't worry about the process. Worry about the product. Okay? So, that part of that fruit, patience, God expects us just to, it's going to happen in increasing amount. Now, we all develop and mature at different rates. You know, and here's the great thing, a good healthy church is going to have people that have been saved for years and years, and that same good healthy church is going to have people that aren't even saved yet. And you're going to have people that's everywhere in between. If your church is full of people that are saved and there's no non-believers in there, there's something wrong. You're not doing something. You're missing something. And we need one another to, iron sharpens iron. We need one another, build one another up. We got to have the mature saints to help mature the younger saints, and to help bring the younger ones or the newer ones. It's not a physical age thing. It's a spiritual age thing. Bring them along. So, you know, hey, you may be at a different level of maturity when it comes to patience or kindness or whatever, but stay connected, and it will develop. And that's why James can say, be. Don't pray for it. Don't ask. Just be. Just be patient. But what's he saying be patient about? He's saying be patient concerning something, and it's the Lord's coming. Look at what he says. Be patient then until the Lord's coming. Now, we don't know when that's going to happen. We know it's closer today than it ever has been. You know, and think about this. This is written in the first century. I mean, this is the first generation of Christians. This is the first generation of the church. And already there were many that were struggling with this idea. Already there were many that were getting frustrated. Hey, it's been 6 months since Jesus arose. You know, when Jesus ascended into heaven on that mountain, and all the believers were standing there watching him, they heard him say, "I'm coming back." They heard, in fact, after Jesus went, the angel stood there and said, "What are you?" To me, it's just a funny picture. What are you guys looking at? Angels standing there looking at them. They're just looking at the sky. Jesus was gone. They couldn't see him anymore. You ever watch an airplane, see how far until you can't see it anymore? Or a helium balloon? That's kind of what they were doing. They couldn't see him anymore. They're just standing there staring. And the angel's like, What are you guys looking at? Jesus left. Don't worry, he's coming back. In the same way that you saw him leave, he's going to come back. Now you got to go get busy doing what he told you to do. They ended up going to the upper room. But they had this sense. They thought he's coming back right away. You know, maybe he's going to be back midweek. Maybe he'll be back Wednesday. We just got to go to that upper room and hang out and pray and wait. You know, they were there for like 10 days before the gift that the Father sent, the Holy Spirit, showed up and blew them all away. They all started speaking in tongues. And I'll bet you they thought when they sensed that wind and they sensed that Holy Spirit welling up within them, and all of a sudden they speak in language that they never spoke before and they don't understand what they're... I'll bet you they thought, he's got to be right here. I mean, he's got to be coming right now. But he wasn't. And the next thing, you know, Peter gets out and he starts talking to the crowds and 3,000 people. And they're like, oh, he's got to be coming tonight. Look at this. We got like 3,000 people saved. This is great. He's got to be... 6 months, a year, 2 years, 10. This is first generation, and they're getting a little bit frustrated because he hasn't come back. And James says, look, be patient. He's coming. He's coming. Don't worry. This is James. This is the brother of Jesus. This isn't James, the brother of John. This is James, the brother of Jesus. He's not only waiting for his Savior to return, he's waiting for his brother to come back. You know, we'd be telling Chloe, or Deb was telling, because I wasn't home, but Chloe wanting to know where Corbin was. Well, Corbin's in the hospital. Corbin's coming back. She knew he was coming back. She had no idea when. And when he showed up yesterday, you should have seen her. I can imagine that's kind of like what the church is going to be like when Jesus actually comes back. If we're actually being patient and waiting for him. If we're ready for him. My daughter posted a little video of them hugging. He got out of the car and he just went over and grabbed, hi, sissy. And it's you can't hardly watch it without getting wet eyes. There's something on that screen that gets in your eyes, dries them out or something. But I picture the return of Jesus to be like that. Hey, son. Hey, sis. Hey, brother. Nice hug. But they were getting frustrated, and we get frustrated. We get discouraged. I mean, we're 2,000 years later. And it's sooner. It's coming. It's coming quicker than we realize. But hey, does that mean this week, next year, next millennium? I don't know. But it's coming. And the word that God gave through James to that first church is the same word for us. Be patient as you wait. Be patient as you wait until he comes. And then he gives this example. He starts talking about the farmer. He says, you know, take for example the farmer. He waits patient for the crop, for the valuable crop. And he's patient for the autumn and the spring rains. The farmer knows that there's seasons, and there's seasons for growth, and there's seasons for letting the land lie fallow, and there's seasons. I mean, it's not that the farmer hasn't done anything. You got to understand, the farmer is he's doing something. He had to till that ground. And then the farmer had to plant that seed. But then, this is in a time before good irrigation, the farmer had to step back and wait and be patient. He just had to trust that the spring and the autumn rains were going to come in season. There's some things you can't control, but you know that they happen. And that's the example of the farmer. Can you imagine if the farmer every day went out and dug up some of those seeds, take a look and see if they were doing anything yet? I planted you a week ago. How come you haven't sprouted? Rather, he'd have a mess on his hand. But we do that. And we don't think anything about it. We'll do some work. We'll do some testifying. We'll do some praying. And then instead of wait, we go and we got to go back and dig up the seed that we planted and wonder, well, how come my friend hasn't responded? You know, I mentioned Jesus' name to him. How come he hasn't started praying? How come he hasn't come to church? How come my friend, how come my coworker or my sibling, whatever, how come they haven't surrendered to the Lord? You're not being patient. Quit digging up the soil. My goodness. Dig up the soil, plant the seed, water it. Maybe somebody else is going to want trust. God cares more about your friend, your coworker, your neighbor, your sibling, whatever, your child, than you ever could. Quit digging up the soil. Do your part and step back and be patient. Another thing that he mentions in this thought, and really kind of goes along with it, is don't grumble against each other. You realize that grumbling is the antithesis, however you want to properly pronounce that, to patience. It's the opposite. In order to grumble against somebody, you have to be paying attention to them rather than your own business. If you're going to have something to grumble about, if you're going to know enough to grumble, you got to be paying more attention to them than you are to your own. It's like the old adage, the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. Well, if you would spend some time watering your own grass, it would be green. Take care of your own grass. You won't have to worry about the other side of the fence. And stop grumbling. He says, don't waste your time grumbling against each other. And it's particularly interesting to me, anyway, that he charges us not to grumble against one another. He's not talking about grumbling against the world. He's not talking about grumbling against the politicians. He's talking about grumbling against one another, the people that are sitting in the same church as you, or the people that are believers saved by the same Jesus, the only Jesus that can save. He's talking about grumbling against them. Don't do that. Why? Well, what causes grumbling besides the fact you're paying more attention to them? I think grumbling is caused by disagreements. Grumbling is caused by differing views. Grumbling is caused by different opinions. Let me ask you this. In your biological family, do you always completely agree with your siblings? I only had one sibling, and I can guarantee you we didn't and don't always agree on everything. There were some times that we would actually grumble. There were some times that we would actually argue. We'd actually throw down every once in a while. Anybody else? You actually get into it with your siblings? Let me ask you this. Does the simple fact that you didn't always agree, or you maybe even came to blows, does that mean you don't have, or that you're not still family? Does that mean that you don't still have the same parents? My brother and I got into some great, I guess I would call them great because I always won because I was bigger. Now, we really didn't fight a lot, but we fought some. But no matter how much we might disagree on different things, we still have the same father. Amen. And the same mother. No matter how much we might disagree, we're both ministers today. And we don't agree completely on every interpretation. We see things a little bit differently in some passages. Fortunately, it's what I would call secondary doctrines. We don't fully agree, but we agree on this. We're still sons of the King. We're still in the same family. I love him to death, and he loves me to death. Sometimes probably wishes I would. No, not anymore. But we're not going to focus on the things that we disagree about. because those are secondary things. Because what we agree on, who is God? How many gods are there? Who is Jesus? How are we saved? What's man's condition? What is sin? The important stuff we agree on wholeheartedly. And so I think what James is getting at here, and what we in this 21st century need to understand, like it or not, there's a whole bunch of different denominations out there that are Christian. There's a whole bunch of people that attend other churches with different names and some different secondary doctrines that are still saved by the same Jesus, serving the same God, adopted into the same family, and they're our brothers and sisters. Don't grumble against them. Don't fight. Don't argue. Don't start throwing down because you disagree with a particular way that they take a secondary doctrine. That's ridiculous. And you know, I have seen more in this 2020. I really don't want to get into talking about 2020 because it's like the only thing that you hear on the news and on the radio. Everything's, it's our new normal and we're all in it. Man, if I hear one more person say we're all in it together, I'm thinking about knocking them out of it. I'm getting so tired. That's my flesh speaking. That's me. That's not the Lord. Forgive me. Don't follow that example. I repent here and now. But I have seen more, a lot of it's been on Facebook. I try not to get on that too much, although when you're sitting in the hospital, there's not an awful lot else to do. But I've seen more battles, even within the assemblies of God, as a result of this COVID and the way that different churches are handling it. Christians calling out other Christians over this. COVID isn't even a spiritual thing. We're talking about a virus. We're talking about and it really doesn't matter how it got here. You know, when my grandson was in the hospital, Deb and I are sitting there thinking, well, how did he get sick? How did the doctors try to figure it out? And I finally came to the point, so you know, it really doesn't matter how. What matters is he is. And that's what you got to deal with. And it really doesn't matter a whole bunch how this COVID got started. It really doesn't matter a whole bunch how you get it, how you don't get it, why, whatever. What matters is if you got it, take care of yourself. Don't go attacking one another because they have it or they don't have it, because they take more precautions or they take less precautions. Quit attacking, especially your brothers and sisters in Christ, because they go to a church that's open or they don't go to a church that's open, because they're worshiping online or because they're worshiping in a car, because they're going in person to a service that's inside or they're going to a service that's outside. Quit attacking other churches, other believers, because their feelings don't line up with your feelings. That's ridiculous. And it totally goes against what we're supposed to be. Man, if we are tearing one another down, if we are beating, did I hear Buzz Lightyear? I swear it's like a to infinity and beyond or something. Maybe I'm just hearing things. Okay. Maybe it was Woody. I don't know. Anyway, let me get back to the point. If we're going to spend so much time tearing our brothers and sisters down, tearing other churches down, pointing fingers at other churches, and defending ourselves when they're pointing fingers at, wow, how attractive is that to the loss that we're supposed to be reaching? What did Jesus say? The lost, will know that you're my disciple. How? By your love one for another. Not your love for them, the lost, although certainly we need to be expressing love to the lost. But he said, they're gonna know there's something different about you by the way you love one another. And that one another doesn't necessarily have to be that person in your house or in the same pew as you, in the same church. Man, if you can't love somebody in another church that's taking different precautions or acting differently, don't expect the lost to say, hey, I want to come and be part of it. I want what you got. Because believe me, they've already got what you got, and it's not helping them, and it's not helping you. Amen. So that's why James says, look, don't grumble against one another. There's an inherent danger in grumbling against your spiritual family, and that is, as I said, it's going to drive others away. You can't be born a Christian. You have to be born again a Christian. You can't be born into this family. You have to be born again into this family, which requires an act of the will, a decision that I make and you make. It says, I'm going to surrender my life to Jesus. I'm going to accept what he did for me. And if it requires that kind of, I've got to show others that this is worth it. This is beneficial. This adds to life. It doesn't detract from it. And that's what's going to be attractive and cause others to want to come to know Jesus. I mean, I don't know how many of you would sit there and given the choice of two or three different families, would choose the most dysfunctional one to be a member of. And I want to be careful when I say it, because I know that there's a lot of people that have grown up in dysfunctional families. And I don't mean any harm by that. But given a choice, if you're sitting there and you're given a choice of two or three different families, you're going to go to the one that actually looks the healthiest and seems the happiest. That's what we as the body of Christ, the church, should be. That's what we should be demonstrating to others, not dysfunction. So let me get back, and I'm actually going to close pretty soon. I mean, there's a lot we could talk about on other thoughts that James has here and continues, but I really just want to finish on patience. Because we may find it hard to focus on patience. We may find it hard to say, God, I know I got to be patient. We might want to just demonstrate other attributes like love. Now, why don't I just love like Jesus loved? Why don't I just love people? And I think that's great, and we ought to be doing that. But if you were to go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, scroll down to verse 4, the very first attribute of love, patience. Love is patient. You don't have patience, you can't demonstrate love. Not fully, not the way the Lord intends. Along with kindness and all these other attributes. But love itself is patient. And God is love. 1 John 4:8 tells us that. God is love. So what's that say about God? God is patient. And if I want to be like God, I need to be patient. But it's not just patience, it's patience with a purpose. First, we've got to have patience with a purpose. Last passage. 2 Peter chapter 3. Verse 9 is where I'm going, but I want to go back up to verse 8. Because there's some context. In fact, we could go all the way up to the start. But James and Peter are writing basically on the same kind of topic. They're writing this to the early church. They're both the same generation. In fact, I am going to go to verse 3. So 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3. Listen to what Peter says, and listen to how this lines up with James. First of all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. Has that happened at all? Anybody seen any of that? People mocking Bible, mocking faith. They'll say, where is this coming? He promised. Ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. In fact, they might even get crazier and talk about, instead of creation, they might talk about, you know, ever since this Big Bang and our earliest forefathers crawled out of some primordial soup with some kind of a crystal on their back and grew legs. That's the basis of evolution. Did you know that? The top evolution scientist, their explanation is that something crawled out of the primordial soup with a crystal on its back. And here we are, I don't know, 20 million years, billion years later, I don't know. I like the creation story myself. Let's stick with that one. Ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning. Verse 5, but they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens existed and the earth was formed out of water and by water. And by these waters also the world at that time was deluged and destroyed. By that same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. So when God makes a reservation, nobody bumps him, by the way. So you don't have to worry about some crazy person over in some other part of the world blowing the world up, or some crazy person in this part of the world blowing the world up. We may have the technology, we're never going to be able to do it because God's made a reservation. So we don't need to live in fear. Don't live in fear. God's got this. Verse 8. Do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. Like, that's a very important word. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Here we go. You ready? He is patient with you. He's patient. We love that. But I gotta admit, it kind of bites me a little bit when I read the next two words, with you. He's patient with me. God has demonstrated incredible patience. He's not slow in keeping his word. He has set a day. He is coming back. He's coming back to take us to be with him. But he's taken a little while because he's patient with you, the church. Why is he patient with us? We're saved. We're ready. We're good to go. Look at what it says. Not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. He's patient with you and with me because there's people out there that don't know him. He's demonstrating great patience with you and me because there's people we're supposed to reach that we haven't reached yet. He's giving us, we like to read that and go, yeah, he's given the lost the opportunity to get saved. He's given them, he's being patient with, no, he's patient with you and me. Because he wants us to be busy about his business. He wants us to be concerned about what he's concerned about. He wants us to love the lost that they might come to know him. He left us in the world that we might do what he was doing and even greater. Now, we're not going to save anybody, but we can lead them to the Savior. And that's what we need to be doing. And yet, sometimes we just get so comfortable in our little Christian cocoons, sitting in our nice, comfortable church, worshiping in the privacy of our nice, comfortable church, that we just, you know, us four no more. Well, I'll put my bumper sticker on, I'll put my sign on, I'll wear a t-shirt or something that talks about Jesus, but, you know, to actually get down and talk with the non-believers, to actually get down and, you know, some of them are into really bad stuff, some are really nasty, some are really dirty. I used to be there, I don't want to be there anymore. He's patient with us so that we can reach them. So back to James, and we'll conclude. Be patient then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop. He's done his part. We need to do ours and be patient. Don't grumble. Remember the prophets that spoke. And you see what the Lord finally brought out. Understand this, verse 11. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, not just for us, but for the lost. He's patient with you. And he's patient with me. And, yeah, I certainly don't want this message to end on a low note, on a bummer. I mean, I think this is great. God is patient. We need to be patient. We need to emulate him. If we haven't been busy about his business, if we've been a little bit too slow, if we've been a little bit too nervous or whatever, what do? We need to repent. Lord, forgive me. If I haven't been doing the good that I know I ought to be doing, as it says earlier in James, hey, it's a sin. What do? Repent. Lord, help me. Help me to overcome my fears. Help me to overcome my frustrations. Help me to overcome all these things that's preventing me from loving those that you died for. Lord, help me to be patient. Let's not be afraid. I think if we're afraid to pray for patience, it's kind of like being afraid to pray to grow. Afraid to pray that we know the Lord better. Afraid to pray that he work in us and through us. The expectation is that we be patient because he's patient. But in our patience that we be busy about his business. Would you stand with me this morning? Yeah. Close with some worship. These altars are open. I want to encourage you, if you want to spend some time in prayer, if you need to